Okay, hi everyone. I just wanted to give you a short video about something that we didn't quite get to talk about on Thursday. So we had introduced the idea of ionotropic synapses versus metabotropic synapses, but we hadn't really talked about their advantages and disadvantages. So an ionotropic synapse begins the same way as a metabotropic synapse. So the presynaptic side is the series of steps that are described in the text of your book and in this figure from your book 13.9, where vesicles of neurotransmitter are triggered to be released by a series of events that occurs after voltage-gated calcium channels open. So the neurotransmitter is released into the synaptic cleft. The example here is the neurotransmitter acetylcholine. And acetylcholine binds to its receptor. In this case, it's an acetylcholine receptor called the nicotinic receptor. You don't have to know that, but it's important only in that acetylcholine also has a metabotropic receptor. So it could either use an ionotropic or metabotropic method. Here it's using an ionotropic method where it opens an ion channel that's actually permeable to both sodium and potassium, but since sodium has a much greater driving force, a much greater distance between the resting membrane potential and its equilibrium potential, what it wants the membrane to be, the dominant effect here is depolarization, sodium coming into the cell. And so the effect then is to depolarize the postsynaptic cell. This number six here is a little misleading because the example they're using is the neuromuscular junction when one neuron synapse is on a muscle. Muscles have action potentials. Neurons do not have action potentials in their dendrites. So if you remember, we were talking about summation, where dendrites receive excitatory postsynaptic potentials by sodium entering them, usually, and they receive inhibitory postsynaptic potentials by either potassium leaving or chloride entering the cell, either of which would make the inside of the cell more negative. And that those ions move around the cell. So if this is the cell that's receiving many inputs, those ions move through the dendrites, some of them move to the cell body, and at the axon hillock here where the axon begins, if there's sufficient depolarization, sodium voltage-gated channels will be opened and there'll be action potentials in the axon. So normally there are not action potentials in the dendrites, so this is only correct because the example they're using is actually a synapse between a neuron and muscle, not between two neurons. At any rate, this is a highly efficient mechanism because it's very fast. The neurotransmitter receptor, see that acetylcholine bound right there, that little dot? The receptor protein is itself the ion channel. So this works extremely fast. And it's very simple. You don't need any other proteins except this protein, which is both the receptor for the neurotransmitter and the ion channel. So ionotropic receptors produce a very fast response. They produce an immediate response. And you only have that one protein that you have to worry about is the postsynaptic cell. It's that one protein. If you compare to a metabotropic synapse, typically what happens is the neurotransmitter binds to its receptor, which changes the shape of a G protein. This is actually in two different panels. That triggers some enzymatic reactions, which then opens an ion channel. So the last question I was going to ask you in class, if we had time, is why would you do that? Why would you go through all of this G protein, you know, enzymatic GTP stuff, when you could just bind your neurotransmitter directly to the ion channel? And there are several reasons. The most important one is that this pathway greatly amplifies the response to the neurotransmitter. So if you go back and look at the ionotropic synapse, Each ion channel is opened when two acetylcholine molecules bind, the one I had before here and the one over here. Whereas here, you have one neurotransmitter binding. That activates the G protein, which then activates an enzyme. And this is a very simple example here, but often there's a series, actually, of enzymes that are activated. And as you know, enzymes are not consumed in the reactions they catalyze. So once an enzyme becomes active, it can catalyze 100, 1,000 different reactions, depending on how much substrate is available. So you can open with this one neurotransmitter molecule bound many ion channels, maybe even hundreds of ion channels. So with just a small amount of neurotransmitter, you can have a tremendous effect on the voltage of the postsynaptic cell. So the fact that you have amplification is a huge advantage of metabotropic synapses. The second benefit, I would say, is that they're modulatable. So that means they're changeable. Here, all you can do, whenever acetylcholine binds, exactly this many potassium channels open or potassium-sodium channels open. We say just cation channels open. So there's nothing you can really change about it. But here, if you were this postsynaptic cell and you wanted to respond more or less to a particular transmitter, you could change the amount of any of these things, the amount of receptor that you put on the membrane, the amount of G protein that was coupled to it, the amount of enzymes that were connected to those G proteins are available in the cell, or the number of potassium channels, which again is a separate protein than the receptor. So any of those things could be changed, and so you have a really flexible response to that neurotransmitter. So you could really have learning, a change in synapses, by a change in any of these proteins. So it's very modulatable. A third advantage of metabotropic synapses over ionotropic synapses is that it is possible with a metabotropic synapse to change something in the postsynaptic cell that is not an ion channel. So at an ionotropic synapse, all you can do is open an ion channel. The receptor is an ion channel. But you know about cell signaling mechanisms from cell bio, and other places, I suppose. And so you know that once a G protein coupled receptor becomes activated, any number of things might occur. Any number of signaling cascades might be activated that could change the movement of a vesicle of proteins to the membrane. It could involve other trafficking within the cell. You could change transcription or translation, the amount of some enzyme, the rate of some other reaction. So there's a whole variety of things that you could do with your neurotransmitter besides just opening ion channels. So to summarize briefly, the advantages of a metabotropic synapse over an ionotropic synapse is that you get amplification of the signal from the neurotransmitter. You have flexibility to respond in different ways at different times to the neurotransmitter as that postsynaptic cell. And the neurotransmitter may trigger changes in the postsynaptic cell besides changes in membrane voltage. So all of those are advantages of metabotropic synapses and reasons why you would have one instead of having an ionotropic synapse. Typically, what happens in animal bodies is that in places where you have a very simple signal to pass, so for example, the neuromuscular junction, where the neuron is just telling the muscle to contract, there's no modulatedness about it. You're just going to contract or you're not going to contract. It's a very simple signal. It needs to occur very quickly. And so you have that change that occurs quickly and easily. If you have synapses in your brain, that's sort of more your more thinky synapses, those typically are metabotropic, especially the ones that are involved in the parts of your brain that are involved in memory. Okay, if you have any questions about that, let me know. And overall, for the synapse chapter, I recommend that you watch the animations. There's two animations that are posted in the folder, and I think that if you watch those, that will be to your advantage. Okay, that's all.